Have you praised the Lord how many times today?
Praise the Lord.
Yeah. I mean, the glory of the Lord. And he desires the praises of men just to glorify him. You know. And it's a wonderful thing. Amen. It's a wonderful thing to praise the Lord, and to give Him honor and to glorify, and to allow Him the honor and the glory, everything.
Yes.
Give thanks unto the Lord for all things. And I'm just about taken by surprise this evening. You know, I was telling Mike, you know, I seemed like I had a readiness about any time, you know, I can do this. And sometimes the lips might go without the mind really, you know, being engaged, but the Lord has in His Word so many wonderful admonitions and do this and do that, and I've been studying over some scriptures that I would like for you to just, you know, mark them down and meditate on them. Meditate on them. Is this, the question is this God's word? Did he really, I mean, is this a part of him expressed here in the Bible? Is this him? And I'm not trying to get traditional on anything. Just what it says here. Of course, where I come from, that, you know, it's, a lot of these things were a common practice. But yet, what does God say? You know, the tradition. Of men, well, it doesn't avail too much. Sometimes it just satisfies, you know, the ones that want to. But God's word, we're trying to satisfy God and please Him and to honor and to glorify Him. And so, I'd like to go to 1 Corinthians 11 for a few verses there. And so if you would study on these and then give me your understanding later on, you know, the next service or so, however, you know, the Lord would lead you. But I have studied these verses in so in depth, you know, I just get one direction, and yet it doesn't seem like, you know, we're, you know, as a church here, you know, that we're practicing this, but what does God say? That's the question. What does he say? We're not going to try to follow anybody but him. And the first verse is verse 4. Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonoreth his head. And his head being Jesus, God. And but if you cover your head when you're praying or prophesying, it says, what I understand is it dishonors the head, your ruling body over you. And verse 7, for a man indeed ought not to cover his head, for as much as he is the image and glory of God, but the woman is the glory of the man. And so, what do you think? You get your inspiration from the Lord. What does it say? And what then should we do? How should we proceed? And then verse 5. Now every woman that prayeth or prophesieth with her head uncovered. Now, it says the man shouldn't cover his head in worship, but it says something about every woman that prayeth or prophesieth with her head uncovered dishonoreth her head. For it's even all one as if she were shaven. And that seems to not be too nice for, you know, ladies to have shaven heads, you know. Verse 10, for this cause ought the woman to have power on her head because of the angels. So there is a reverence that is given, is shown. The woman would show it by covering her head in honor to the her head, her husband. And verse 13, judge in yourselves, is it comely that a woman pray unto God uncovered? You might wonder how it is that, you know, coming from Amish, Mennonite, and Dunkards, where the practices were very rigid. I mean, they're very rigid on this. Why that, you know, would I be an assembly like this? Well, how could I be satisfied? Well, there's a number of things that come to mind and that we look at and view on and from the Word of God, and a hunger and a desire to be fed. And that's my heart's desire of being fed and led. You know, the body of believers and the headship of the body is to lead the body, to guide the body, and to be in one with the body. And so there's a lot of things that, you know, one's heart would desire over and above of where we have been. And so I realize my track record, I'm not trying to set a pattern for someone else to follow the pattern that I have taken down through the years. But anyway, with these scriptures in mind of, you know, what is what is God saying here, and what should we do? You know, I'm not in authority to make explanations in that of you must do this, you've got to do this. You know, I don't have that authority, but I do have some questions that seem like I can always come up with them. But there's an end in mind. The fullness of the body, the rejoicing of the body, the care of the body, one to another. There's so much in real Christendom, rather than just a place to meet and say, "Well, I went to church. You know, I went to a church house." But did you have church? And that's my desire. You know, when I go to church, I like to really be in church and have church and allow the church to have its sway in me, in that of developing the spiritual life. Yes, the eye care system, that is also most important, I think, ingredient to the body of believers, to care one for the other. And in such a way as to, we go out of our way to help and to strengthen and to encourage and to help, be of assistance. And whatever that assistance might be, you know, whatever the condition is, and being led of the Lord, then to provide for brother or sister in need. And of course, when we come together to worship, you know, say like this evening, I didn't see any list of needs that on other people. What do you need? You come to church, what are you wanting? What do you want? What do you need? And how are you going to get it? And this process that we have, coming together and worshiping the way we do and singing the songs and meditating and praying and listening to encouragement, is it working for us? Do you really enjoy it? Do you give God the glory? Is this where God sent you to be? So probably have enough things on mind to give consideration, but if you'd like to help me, with those scriptures in that of confirming. I mean, do I read them right? Do I understand them right? And what is God really saying? And I think we could work together and get understanding of the Lord. It's not that difficult. We don't have to have 75 rules and regulations to follow by. Just what comes from the Word of God, What does he say? What does he say to do? You going to do it? Do you want to? And would you desire to be of assistance and explain this to someone else? Even the gift of salvation is so easy and simple, but how many times do we really seek and to ask and then to follow through with somebody that doesn't know the Lord as a personal Savior? They might say they're Christian, but do you have Christ? Is Christ your leader, the God? Do you work through them and then assist them of how to go about that? It's a wonderful experience. We've all had that, I'm sure. Surely, with all the preaching that has come forth, surely it gives us understanding and desire to do that. But then the real follow-through, the real deal, are we the real deal? And I was listening to a tape here the other day, and he was saying, did you give God the glory for everything? When you got up this morning, did you give God the glory? Did you praise his name for the wonderful night's sleep and to be able to wake and the opportunities that are before you? Did you thank him? Did you glorify his name? And that's a starting place, and then just go from there on as the Lord, listening to the Lord. And following after him. Just as a passing, that's why I have a lady with me from Oregon. Lord said, she's the one I want you to, you love her and be a good husband to her. And that direction. So with the recommendation that the Lord has given, and I got it several directions, and then as I go, we go along through our married life, I mean, he has confirmed things, and so I, now I have got upset. I'll have to, if you want to know the truth, I have got upset to the point of, once I went out to the living room, and where can I go? I mean, loose speech, Lord said, you're not going anywhere. Yes, I know it. I was just teasing, I didn't really mean it. See, I can't leave her because of what God said. I'm hooked. I mean, hook, line, and sinker. I mean, I'm hooked. I got to follow. I mean, I've got to be a husband to her. Whether what she does, whether, regardless of what she does, I have to be a good husband. And that's very possible. My grandpa taught me how to do that. He was, I went to them, at 9 after Mama left. And he taught me how to do this very thing. He had a wife. Oh, Grandma, bless her heart. You know, she had a lot of good ideas, but some of them weren't so good. She would pick on Grandpa terribly. Just about everything he did. He couldn't do anything right. She'd pick on him. This is right, you know, look at your clothes. I mean, the spots here, about there, you know. And she'd just pick on him. And I thought, the way she picked on Grandpa, you know, if she would die first, he would probably, you know, have a sigh of relief. And lo and behold, I was the one with the message from the hospital that Grandma died. And instead of that pause of relief, he cried his heart out. He was heartbroken. And I thought, you mean that woman that treated you like this, and you loved her like that? And I don't really understand that. But that's the way it was. You know, Grandpa didn't argue with Grandma. He'd say one time, this is the way it was and is, and then leave it. And she would, you know, kind of keep it carrying on and on. But he wouldn't. He wouldn't argue. I never heard him argue with Grandma. He was kind and gentle, and even the two boys that they took on to help raise me and my brother. My sister was all right, but me and my brother, we weren't mean. We just got into a lot of stuff. Grandma, she did not like to correct the children. She would say, one more time and you're going to get it. I told you one more time and you're going to get it. Grandpa, he just, when he had enough, he would say, Buva, or that's German, boys, just, you know, so we heard him, boys. And that was the signal to settle down, because if we didn't, then we got it. We knew that. So when we heard boys, we straightened up. You know, there's a loving way and an understanding way and a caring way and a God's way to help correct children and so forth. I've been so blessed. I've been so blessed. I'm still working on the many times that I was close to death in my lifetime, and then also what did die, but I've been close to death, and yet I was saved. And you wonder, well, why? how's this? Why is this? You know, but there's reasons for it. And so maybe sometime I'll have opportunity to tell you all those. There are over 10 close calls. I could have died at each one. but didn't. And so here we are. Praise the Lord. Well,
praise the Lord.
Okay. Yes, prayer. Yeah, I didn't have a list of the of what we're supposed to do next, but thanks for your help. Do we have any prayer requests or situations that you have that you would like it to change to the better? Yes.
Cindy had a good report on Tuesday. She's been running a PICC line in her arm, running penicillin in there. It's supposed to be for 6 weeks, and they'll be taking it out next a week from this Friday. So the recovery's a little bit ahead of schedule, which I'm glad of. She's actually in Kansas right now, visiting our great grandson, whom I haven't seen yet, who she's seeing for the first time now. So stepdaughter and grandsons went with her. So I'm praying for her to have an awesome time and welcome our first great grandson into our lives, and for her to just have a time of refreshing and relaxing. And Sunday morning had a little mishap, and all the symptoms up even clear through Monday night were showing that I ruptured a disc in my back, because I had this same exact scenario happen 30 years ago. Caused by a different reason, but the symptoms were exactly the same. But just claiming healing clear through Monday night, all Monday night, I knew what was going on and stuff like that. And I don't know if it was yesterday morning or this morning, I tested those symptoms and they couldn't manifest. So I don't see any situation with any disc injury, just a little bit of muscle injury, which is recovering fast, and thanking the Lord for being faithful.
Okay.
Yeah, I need to pray for Dan for healing.
I think probably the biggest thing in my heart is prayer for this nation.
Yes.
Our leadership. Searching on myself from things that I came out of. And am I carrying some of this stuff that I had no business carrying? And that's why I got to ask myself this too. So I believe we're at the threshold of a mighty move of God, and I believe it's going to happen here big time. And I believe the more we embrace it and put our
Okay. Well, let's stand and present these to God, which has a desire to answer. There's a reason why we pray. Because the activity that will follow, no Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
We love you. We love you. And thank you for our very being and the way that you operate. And, oh, yes, Lord. Even that couple that at Hy-Vee, you know, they lost a daughter in the water, but you have blessed their life and blessed their life. So, Lord, we pray a blessing to them in a continual way. And to Cindy and Mike, as they work together, one assisting the other, Lord, just bless them. Bless them deeply. And so that their outreach has an effect. And then things happen. Bless Mike's back. Healing. Healed in the name of Jesus. Yes, healed. Healed in the name of Jesus. And we pray for Dan's healing also.
Yes, Lord.
Oh, yeah. You said you didn't restrain us in any form of praying for you, but just bring all things unto you said. So we thank you. And we pray, Lord, for the leadership of the country. You know, the last several years that we have gone through and the ground that has been lost and the way that things have backed up and just the evil seemingly having full reign, but not so. You're still in charge, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you. And we pray for guidance and direction to our leadership and also to the church leadership.
Yes,
that they come out and lead as you have designed them. Not only in the churches, but also elsewhere. To take the forefront and lead and guide and direct and assist and show the Word of God. And Lord, never, don't want to forget the love that you give to me through Mama and Grandpa. We pray that love, the reminder of it, grasp hold in and is released to honor and to glorify you and help and assist others, care for others, love on them deeply, because you've designed us to do that to other people. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And pray your blessing on the meeting this evening and Brother Pastor as he guides us in the Word. That it was worthwhile, it was good that we were here. We didn't just come to have a meeting. We come to worship God and to be guided and directed. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. In Jesus' holy name. Amen. I guess that means me too. Oh, glory to God. Yeah.
Sally, have any input for the women's conference?
I don't really know anymore what they said last week. We still have a lot of things to bring together, so
okay.
We'll meet again probably on Sunday.
Amen. Okay, I'll just speak the word.
Okay. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak with new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they too recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body, and that
any disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection which God created to function,
and I forbid any malfunction of this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation of the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but I am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
Rod, could you come and assist us in the offering? And pray for us too. We need prayer from you. Would you? Miracle's still in operation.
I'm just having a
are so worthy, Lord, of our praise.
We love you.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that we don't have to fear you because we know your love for us is so real. Love for us is so real, Lord. And we can just come into your everlasting loving arms, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for unraveling me, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. We love you tonight, Lord. Thank you so much, Jesus, for making us your children. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us into the family of God. We just bless you tonight, Lord, for all of your goodness and all of your grace, for all of your love wherewith you have loved us. And we just bless you tonight, Lord, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand tonight. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Mike and the worship team. Praise the Lord. And thank you, Alvin, for opening. Appreciate it. Praise God. There's some questions out there for us that we can certainly take a look at. And coming from a background of Holiness Church, I kind of know some of that you're talking about. And I'm not, I won't spend a lot of time on it right now, but because I do believe you're sincere and serious about this, I will be respectful to answer at least briefly right now before I get into the message. And in Hebrews 11, if we read it in the context that this is the early church was mainly, they started out with Jewish believers. That's who they were reaching first. And then there were Gentiles that would come in. So there was always controversy between Jewish traditions and New Testament traditions. Now, what he's talking about there, you can go back and check in Numbers, I believe it is Numbers chapter 5, because it talks about what this is referring to actually is a jealousy offering, or when a man is jealous of his wife, if she may have been with somebody else, he doesn't know, but he has a suspicion, and so he would come before the church or before the priest and tell them, and they would unveil the woman or take the covering from her head, and then they would give her bitter waters, and there was a whole process that they went through. And so that's part of it. It's showing that she disrespected her husband is what that amounted to. Now, if you read the whole thing here in Hebrews 11, or excuse me, in 1 Corinthians 11, he says, if any man seem to be contentious, this is after he has said these things. So if anybody has disagreement with this, he says, that's what he's talking about when he says, if any man be contentious, that's verse 16. He says, we have no such custom, neither the churches of God. So he's been addressing a situation that has come up in terms of the Jewish believers and the question of whether or not this is going to be a thing that needs to be done. Hey, they had the right to do it if they wanted to, but it wasn't something that was being declared, this is a commandment from God. This is just a tradition that has gone on for centuries. And they were still struggling with whether the Gentiles coming in were going to have to do this, how they're going to do all that. He pretty much answers the question in verse 16 by saying, if anybody seems to be contentious or argue about this, whether we have to or don't have to, he said, we don't have such a custom. So that pretty much tells you that. Well, if that weren't enough, what he says as verse 12, for as the woman is of the man, even so is the man also by the woman. But all things are of God. And then he goes on to say that, I could just go back to scriptures over and over throughout the Bible, but let me just give you one from Galatians chapter 3, and you can look these all up for yourself because they're there. He says, there's neither Jew nor Greek, neither bond nor free, neither male or female. All are one in Christ. So all of these things that had been divisions and typically degrading of the woman or demeaning of the woman, he says that stuff doesn't exist anymore as far as the church is concerned. It may be in the culture, and it certainly was in the culture, but it wasn't to be that way in the church. And that's why Jesus said to the, or actually they refer to Jesus and they say that, okay, here's the bottom line. Husbands, love your wives. Wives, respect your husbands. That's it.
Right.
There isn't an outward way of doing that. There are symbolic things you could do, But listen, I've been there. In fact, we had a woman right here in this church that was so disrespectful to her husband and embarrassed him and humiliated him in front of people all the time. She had hair that drug the ground. Now you can ask some that were here. And we had the same conversation, and I told her. She said, well, angels are looking at this. I said, you think angels can't hear? If they can see, they can hear, and they can hear how disrespectful you are to your husband. So no matter how much covering you got, if it's not coming from the heart, it's all irrelevant. It's all meaningless, and that's the point that Jesus is trying to make here. We can make ourselves look like anything we want to make ourselves look like, but it's the heart that God's looking at. So we either love our wives or we don't. And we either respect our husbands or we don't. And that's what he's asking for. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. In other words, give yourself completely to her. Jesus, even when we don't, and you said it yourself, even when we screw up, Jesus doesn't hold us against us. He forgives us, right? And that's why we love him. That's why we respect him, because we know it's not a love that is dependent on my doing certain things that are going to get his favor. He's already given me his favor. He gave his life for me. So how can I not respect him? I want to do right things. I want to do things that please him. But I'm a human being, and I do screw up sometimes, praise the Lord. I don't do everything perfectly. But I find it to be counterproductive. This is my opinion. But I find it counterproductive to try to make ourselves look a certain way in order to then cause us to act a certain way, because it doesn't work that way. It works just the opposite. If it isn't in our heart to do it in the first place, you can make people look any way they want to, but it doesn't change who they are and what they are. And that's what Jesus was at. He was at the core of the issue, love and respect in every relationship. So that's my 2 cents worth. But again, you know, there's so much teaching in the scripture that, you know, I sat under this for years and years and years too. So there still can be question and there can be debate. You have every right to disagree with me, but I'm just saying this is where I'm coming from, okay? That's why I don't preach this, because I've already been down that road and I've seen the hypocrisy that grows out of it. And that's worse than the actual problem, if you understand what I'm saying. Because now you've got guilt, you've got shame, you've got all these other things going on. It's just not helpful. There's neither Jew nor Greek, male or female. As far as God's concerned, we're equals, right? He's just saying in a marriage, there should be love and respect. The truth is, women want love, but that love is different for every woman. Some women, you bring them flowers, give them candy. They think, woo, he loves me, that's great. Others, you bring flowers and they tell you that was a waste of money, right? Praise the Lord. So you have to find the thing that helps them feel loved. That's our responsibility. I don't know about anybody else, but I don't do that perfectly. Men, on the other hand, really want respect more than they want anything else. They want to be respected because that's how we feel loved. In other words, if I know my wife respects me and honors me that way, then I feel loved. I don't need honey, I love you 3 times or 4 times or 5 times a day. I like it. It's good, but I don't need that. What I need is to know that I'm respected. That's just the way we're built, okay? And how that is shown is different for all people too. You know what I'm saying? So that's my 2 cents anyway. Praise the Lord. So hallelujah.
Thank you.
I think the simplest thing is just that when you go through the scriptures, especially in the New Testament, what you find over and over, what Jesus is trying to establish is this oneness, this equality. Jews are no better than Gentiles, and vice versa. Men are no greater or better than women in the kingdom of God. They are one and the same as far as God's concerned. So that's the way we should look at it, or at least that's the way we should try to look at it. Praise the Lord. Okay, amen. Let's go really fast now. Hallelujah. I want to start in Daniel chapter 2 and read verse 47. Daniel 2 and verse 47, and we're going to talk about kind of what Ron was saying about Revelation and how we are to operate in the new covenant. Have I got my mic on? I don't know if I ever turned it on or not. It is now. Praise the Lord. Sorry about that. I just pierced somebody's eardrums up there. Daniel 2:47 says, the king answered unto Daniel and said, of a truth, it is that your God is a God of gods and a Lord of kings and a revealer of secrets, seeing thou couldest reveal the secret. So Daniel had interpreted the dream that none of the soothsayers or their people, you know, their religious people, none of them could answer, figure out what the dream was about. Daniel interprets the dream, right? We all know the story, and that's what the king here is referring to. He said, your God, he's the Lord of kings, he's the God of gods, and he is a revealer of secrets.
Yes.
Okay, Galatians chapter 1, verses 11 and 12. And it's the way that we should approach the word of God, is that we all know that there is I've said it before, it's almost like a matrix, you know, there is what's on the surface and it's all true, it's all real. But generally, the more we seek to find what God is trying to say to us, the deeper it goes, the more we begin to see, right? The more he begins to reveal to us, praise the Lord, because all of a sudden it can become personal. And how many of you know, you can read a scripture a dozen times, but if it isn't something you're actually dealing with, I mean, if it isn't a life experience that you're dealing with, it's just good. It's just a good word, you know. It's powerful. It's positive. But when it's something that you're actually dealing with yourself, all of a sudden it does become exact, right? It goes deeper than just superficial, right? So anyway, here in Galatians chapter 1, in verse 11, he says, "But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. For I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ." So the letter kills, right?
Right.
But the Spirit gives life. So you can read the law. You can read the Bible as a law, as just letter upon letter, and it'll kill you.
Right.
But if you read it by the Spirit, you begin to see that there's life here. There's things God's trying to give us and put into us that build us up. That, you know, it's why he says, look, if a prophet comes, a prophet, if it isn't edifying. Now, under the Old Testament, there was a lot of ugly stuff prophesied, was there not? But in the New Testament, a prophet is to build up, to edify, and to encourage. What I do when I'm up here preaching, what any preacher is doing, he's prophesying if he's reading the Word of God, because it is the word of prophecy.
Right.
I may not be predicting the future in terms of just telling some unknown event, but I'm speaking to the Spirit. I'm speaking to the future in terms of what the Word of God says. So if I'm going to preach, I'm going to preach to build up, to edify, and to encourage.
Uh-huh.
The devil will take care of all the other stuff. He'll see to it you're ashamed and guilty and feeling bad and, you know, threatened and fearful and all that. That's not my job.
Right.
And I don't want it. Praise the Lord. So our responsibility is to try to look at what Jesus preached and who he preached to.
Yep.
Sinners. Why didn't he say to the woman who was caught in the act of adultery, "You filthy wretch, you tramp, get the rocks. I'll be the first one to throw." In fact, he was the only one that had a right to throw a stone. And he says, "I don't condemn you. Go and sin no more." Amen. And that's the theme of everything Jesus preaches. Therefore, that should be the theme of the New Testament church, because he is setting us up for the kingdom.
Yes.
He's upsetting all the Jewish traditions, because he's teaching this stuff to Jews mainly.
Right.
With a few exceptions, there were Gentiles that came along. But he came to bring this message to the Jews. Why? Because he was preparing them for this big upside down thing that's going to take place. Everything that you've been putting your hope in and your purpose in is going to get flipped on its head, and we're going to be moving into a whole other realm here, and you're going to have to start learning to live by the Spirit that you don't have yet, but you're going to get it. It's going to come.
Come on.
And you're going to have to learn to stop using intellect all the time and start using the Spirit to lead you and to guide you. Praise the Lord. So that's what Paul is. He starts right off by saying, hey, look, I was a Pharisee of Pharisees, was I not? You know, I mean, he knew the law, and he kept the law. But he said, I'm telling you something, brothers, the gospel which was preached of me, the gospel that I preached to you, the gospel of Jesus Christ, the gospel of grace, he said, it didn't come to be by man. I didn't hear it from another preacher. Somebody didn't come and tell me this. Because I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Jesus himself came. The Spirit of Christ came and revealed what Paul was going to preach. Now, I'll tell you what. I don't think I'd argue with that.
Nope.
And he didn't even think. All he said was, "Who art thou, Lord?"
Right. Yeah.
And he said, "Jesus, whom you persecute."
Right.
And he laid 3 days blind until another Christian came and prayed, laid hands on him and prayed for him and his eyes to be opened so that he could see.
There you go.
And he went about spending the rest of his life being abused and ridiculed and attacked for preaching this message. But it wasn't a message that he had learned by rote. It was a lesson that came to his heart and couldn't be taken from him.
Amen.
No matter how much he was tormented, no matter how much he was abused and imprisoned, it was real to him. That is because it was revelation, and that's what I'm talking about. I'd rather have 5 minutes of revelation than 30 years of school.
Amen.
Because the schooling, education, it changes all the time. Believe me. Because stuff that they're teaching today, they weren't teaching when I was in school.
Thank God.
Right? And all of us know that if we're, of any age. The things that I learned by the Spirit, they don't change.
That's right.
They're the same, just like God. Yesterday, today, and forever. They are eternal. Natural things, amen, they're temporal. Amen. So anyway, in Aramaic, the word mystery describes the sovereign decision of a king that is made known only to his innermost council, and it's kept secret from everybody else until it's revealed in its execution. Okay? Now, a couple examples. I won't have you go there, Mike, just for the sake of time, but in Job 1:6, it talks about all these angels and Satan come for this meeting with God. Right? And God says, "Have you considered my servant Job?" It's a secret. Nobody else knows about this. Job doesn't know about it. Nobody on earth knows about it. Only those angelic beings that were in the place with God when this meeting is going on. Okay? It's a mystery to everybody else. And we know that if you read Job, it was a mystery. Because Job had it all screwed up until he gets to the very end of it and realizes God's the one that knows what's right and what's wrong. God's the one that knows what's going on here.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
Then in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8, we got the same thing because he says, "I was in the temple and I saw the Lord high and lifted up." He has this encounter with God, this revelatory encounter with God. And God puts a coal to his lips and he says, you're not unclean. And then he says, "Who will go? Here am I, send me," right? The only one that knows about this prophetic thing that's going on is God. And Isaiah, right?
Right?
Nobody else knows anything about this. And then Isaiah goes on to prophesy all these prophetic words about the coming of the Lord and all the things that we talked about over the years. But that was another one of these mysteries. Amen? That's an example anyway. So mystery in the Bible can be defined as the secret thoughts or plans and dispensations of God that are hidden to anyone or anything beneath the divine level. Now, the good news about that is we have been engrafted in. We're now sons of God, are we not?
Yes.
So we can believe and expect that God will give us revelation. God will reveal mysteries to us that other people don't get. Right?
Yep.
I mean, give the Bible to an unbeliever and it's just a bunch of craziness.
Glory.
They don't understand it at all. I'll just give you an example. There are... We talk about two covenants. We always think of it as the Old Covenant, the New Covenant. But there were at least five covenants within the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
And so people will look and they'll say, "Well, this God is horrible because look, he's out there killing all people." God was in covenant with Jews. Now, there are different kinds of covenants, but some covenants are ones where, look, I have to protect you. I'm committed to protect you. Even when you're wrong, I have to protect you. But if you break the covenant, then I got to punish you.
Right.
Now, he's not going to break the covenant.
Right.
So when people would come against Israel, he was covenanted to destroy those people. Not that necessarily God wanted to kill everybody, but he was obligated by the covenant.
Right.
He had to. For the same reason that when the Jews would rebel against God and break the covenant, he had to punish them.
Right.
So all covenants are not the same, and there's more than, you know, there's different kinds of covenants. And so sometimes we read the Bible, and other people look at the Bible, they go, wow, who wants to serve a God like that? I do, because if he's for me, I'm not worried about who's against me. Amen? And the good news is, under the new covenant, he made the covenant with himself, so when I foul up and break the covenant, he will not hold me accountable. He's already held Jesus accountable for my breaking the covenant.
Thank you, Lord.
The blood's already been shed, so I don't have to worry about it.
Come on.
It's all good between me and Jesus. Now, I want to do what's right simply because of how good God is.
Yes.
But you see, you understand what I'm saying? We're just dealing with all kinds of stuff that we don't really even understand a lot of times. And people are making judgments about God without having any basis upon which to make the judgment. Amen. So, look at John chapter 1, verses 14, and then we'll go to 18, so beginning at verse 14. And we know the scripture, he says, and the Word became flesh, right? The Word was made flesh, dwelt among us, we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Right? The Word was flesh, dwelt among us. All right? Verse 18. No man has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him. Now, Paul tells us that we do have understanding. You look at that and you say, well, I've never seen God. Obviously, nobody has. And I didn't see Jesus, right? But I still believe. And why? Because Paul says we have understanding that isn't based on literal teaching or, you know, the normal way that we would learn something by sense, by touching, by seeing, by feeling, by hearing, right? Colossians 2, verses 2 and 3. And that's another reason why we believe, or I do, that the Word was in God, the Word was made flesh, becomes the Son of God, we get born again by the Word, of the Word, what comes into us is the Spirit of the Word. Without that, we couldn't get revelation. Without that, it would always just be more information that we'd be dealing with. But because we have the Spirit of the Word living in us, that Word could come alive and become revelation instead of just information, right? So he says, that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of the understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So he says, their hearts can be comforted. Our hearts can be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and the Father, of the Father and of Christ. So we have every right and every reason, assurance, that we will have understanding concerning the mysteries of God, in whom are hid all the best treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Everything that there is to know, he already knows it. Right?
Right.
So there's no limit to what we can know. Now we know some things. And we think because we know a few things, we know everything. Now, we just know what we know. But there's more to know. That's called revelation.
Yep.
Amen? I don't want to just see what happens in religion is you learn certain information, then you just live off that information for the rest of your life. That isn't the way we're supposed to live. We're supposed to live by revelation, by the Spirit of the Word. Supposed to make us alive and excited and happy and excited about the next day, tomorrow, what's God going to do tomorrow? You know, that never changes, Ron. If you're 30 years old or 70 years old, or 80 or 90 or however long we're here, see, that the spirit man doesn't waste away. He doesn't age. He's renewed every day. That's why we get up in the morning, we look in the mirror, we go, who the heck is that? I'm still thinking I'm 20.
Come on.
You know what I mean? In my mind. Why? Because we're spirit beings first.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. And so look, he says, the mystery In fact, in the end, the mystery is Jesus Christ himself.
Yes.
And we know that if all the books that could be written about Jesus were written, they'd fill all the libraries in all the world.
Right.
So there's a whole bunch of stuff about Jesus we don't know.
Right.
I'd like to know some more stuff about Jesus before I get out of this planet, mm-hmm. before I leave here, before I meet him face to face. Okay, so Colossians 1, verse 26. Even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to the saints. What's that? That's Christ, right? All right, look at Ephesians 1 and 9. Having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself. Okay, Ephesians 3 and 9. And to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. By the word, did he not? Everything that was created, he created by words. He spoke, and everything came into existence. That was Jesus. All right, Romans chapter 16 and verse 25. Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery which was kept secret since the world began. Okay, and so while this mystery is now out in the open, Jesus, right? It's not exhausted. In other words, the mystery's out in the open, but there's more to the mystery than we know.
Yes.
It's inexhaustible, in other words. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. That tells me there's all kinds of exceeding stuff, exceedingly more than what we have, amen, that we don't have. He's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in me. I don't even have questions for the answers yet. See what I'm saying? I don't even know what question to ask. That's why I need the Spirit. Because there's stuff God wants to reveal to me. But how many of you know God has spoken to you about things in the past and you didn't get it?
Right.
You know what he was talking about? It was like he was speaking a foreign language or something. Why? Because we didn't have the question for him. He's answering questions that we haven't got questions for yet. We haven't asked yet.
Right.
It'll come. The day will come when the question will come to you and you'll go, aha! That's what he was talking about. Has that happened to anybody? Praise the Lord. I know it has to me, and it has to all of us probably, right?
Amen.
So the mystery that Paul talks about, why don't we pursue it more? Why don't we just say, well, Jesus came, he died, he was buried, he was resurrected, and sent back the Spirit, ta-da. That's basically where religion and the church has stayed. But there's all kinds of things here that God wants to reveal to us, but we're not really pursuing it. And a lot of Christians see it like it's like a rotary dialed telephone. All of us remember that, right? We're all old enough in this room today to remember rotary, the old black rotary dial telephone. In fact, I went back before in the little town I grew up, they didn't have a dial. You just pick up the phone and say, give me Leroy White's address or phone number, you know, and they just connect you. But anyway, to my point, the church, religion, is basically living like, you know, the rotary dial telephone in the age of smartphones.
Right.
Praise the Lord. And that's good for a museum or the few people who collect old phones, right? In other words, we only ask questions that we already have the answers to.
Come on.
That's the epitome of religion.
Yep.
We just keep saying the same stuff over and over, week after week, week after week, week after week, week after week. We don't ask any more questions. We only ask the ones we already got the answers for. Because we're afraid we might get revelation, then I'd have to leave the church. That's why we got all the denominations we've got. Because somebody asked a question, God answered it, and the church didn't want any part of it because they already had their revelation 100 years earlier. Praise the Lord. That's denominationalism. That's religion.
Yep.
But look at this. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. We'll read 7 through 14. 1 Corinthians 2, verses 7 through 14. See, this is supposed to be exciting. It's not supposed to be preparing for a test every week. You know, just memorizing a bunch of stuff so that I can pass the test. This is supposed to be about revelation. This is supposed to be about something that excites us, that stimulates us. Praise the Lord. So we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew. Because had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, I have not seen nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. See, there's so much that God has prepared for us. But we just keep asking the same questions, knowing what the answers are, so we never get past it yet. We never get to that place, right? But God has revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man, which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man, but by the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. You got to know them by the Spirit. That's so that we can know them, right? Which things also we speak, not in the words which men's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual with spiritual. That's kind of a paraphrase of what Paul said. I didn't get this gospel, nor did I preach this gospel by men's knowledge. But I got revelation. So, which things also we speak. We don't speak which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Ghost teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, because they're foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned.
There you go.
Praise God. So God's mystery always comes as a revelation. God always takes the initiative.
Yes.
Out of the silence of God's own mystery, he speaks to us. God told me this 20 years ago now, I think, thereabouts. And I've said it before, and I know everybody looks at me and goes, God, here he goes again. But when I resigned the church, the Holiness Apostolic Church that I pastored, and dropped my membership with the organization that I had been ordained in, licensed and so on and so forth, and refused to renew my license with them, God told me in prayer in the church building in Ankeny, that if I didn't go back to the Bible, pick it up, and read it as though I had never read it before, nothing was ever going to change.
Right.
So what was God saying to me? I struggled with it for years. And little by little, the Lord showed me. To receive, it takes intellectual repentance. You have to read, in other words, with intellectual inadequacy. Because what I knew is what was ruining me.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? You can't. He said it to me like, unless you read it like you haven't read it before. In other words, you got to repent of what you know in order to learn anything else.
Right.
Because you're so hung up on what you know, I can't get anything else to you.
Right.
You think you got all the answers. You think you already know, and therefore you're stuck with what you know. That's typical of the church. So we have to read it with what I call intellectual inadequacy, which is, it's what we use to identify the sense of sin. You know, I wish I could do better, but I don't, right? I want to do better, but I somehow keep screwing up. See, it's the intellectual inadequacy that puts us in touch with the mystery of God. It's me knowing that I don't know everything that puts me in touch with what God knows. It's me saying, God, give me more. And I'm not gonna force it into my theology. I'm not gonna force it into my denominational doctrinal belief. I'm just gonna receive it from you. And if it isn't contradicted in the Word of God, I'm gonna just say, praise the Lord. That's from God. That's revelation. And it's the only way we can get revelation. It's in the mystery, see? It's in the hiddenness that God weans us away from creating Him in our image or in the image of our particular denomination or our church or our religion. Am I making sense?
Yep. Yeah.
All right, look at Colossians chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. See, it's the foolishness of men that God uses. It's what we don't know that's actually benefits us. Because what we think we know, it ends up being our wisdom becomes stupidity to God. It becomes foolishness to God. Because you can't know these things by the flesh. You can't know them by the intellect. You've got to get them by the Spirit. It has to come to the Spirit first before it gets to your intellect. Praise the Lord. So even the mystery which has been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to the saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, or the Word of God in you, the seed for all revelation, amen, is in you. The Bible mysteries aren't museum exhibits that we look at once in a while and ask what we already know. No, we inhabit them. We inhabit the mysteries. And as we do, they open us up to God's mystery.
Yes, Lord.
Praise the Lord. John 17, verse 21.
That they may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. We inhabit the relational being of the Godhead.
And so people, you know, some ask, well, what did you keep preaching this one thing and God and, you know, what? Move on. Listen, we need revelation.
Right.
Now, maybe y'all got it, but it was revelation to me when I started seeing it, and that's why I'm still talking about it. Because I know within that revelation is the key or the door to greater revelation. If I don't get this, if I can't get this and absorb this and embrace this, this is outrageous. This is stuff like Jesus saying the Father and I are one, and they want to kill him.
Right.
And now we're saying, his brothers, we're saying, hey, this is more than just something, a doctrine that was taught in the church. This is a living, breathing reality. We are one with God. We are in the Godhead.
Yes, Lord.
We have access to the mind of God, the creator of all things.
Mm-hmm.
You think the word might start making more sense if we had God, the Spirit that wrote it, as the interpreter. So, as we inhabit these mysteries, they cause us to, or warn us against, the supposing we have all the mystery captured in our theology. How many of you know, in most churches, you move outside of that theology, you're on shaky ground with the church and with everybody else.
Yep.
You become a blasphemer. You become to be shunned. I've been there. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
You move beyond the theology that they're in. You start asking questions. You start looking at things in a little bit different way, and all of a sudden, whoa, get your trouble. You're causing problems. Why? Because you're asking questions they don't have answers to.
Exactly.
They only want the questions asked that we already have answers for. Because otherwise it's going to be revelation and they can't control that.
Exactly.
The word mystery itself comes from the Greek word muin. M-U-E-I-N. And you know what that word means? Shut your mouth. No, it means close the mouth. Same thing. Praise the Lord. So a mystery is something before which we close our mouths. Mm. We go, quick to hear, slow to speak. How many get a revelation and you're thinking, man, I'd like to share this, but I'm not sure what I know.
Right.
Right?
Right.
That's why he says mystery, that word is, it shuts you up. It'll shut your mouth. It'll stop you from speaking. That's why a lot of times people get up and they want to share before they really know what they're sharing. And what happens is, and I'm not against people sharing, I'm just saying they're sharing stuff that isn't revelation to them yet. And because it isn't revelation, they haven't lived it. They don't really understand it. So it doesn't really produce what it's supposed to produce in their life.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? So look at Romans chapter 3, verse 11. So a mystery is something which we close our mouth. We contemplate it in awe. In silence. You know, when I get something, I'm not preaching it the next day. Because I don't know what it is. I'm not sure what in the heck it is that I'm hearing.
Right.
And I know it happens to all of us, right?
Yep.
So you start looking at the scripture, you start praying, you shut your mouth and start trying to figure out what is it God's trying to say to me.
Exactly.
And all of a sudden things start to pop. You see it here, you see it there, and then it starts to take on a reality of its own. It resonates. It becomes revelation. You see what I'm saying? Okay? So, there is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. All right? Verse 19. Now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. So we ask questions, and we're drawn into a more profound silence. See, they're talking about stuff that these people had lived under for thousands of years. And when Jesus comes along, and then Paul and others come along and begin to tell them, hey, law is just for people that are under the law. If you've come to Christ, you're no longer under the law. You can't be in both. And it shut their mouth. They don't know what to say. It's revelation. But it's not revelation to them yet. It's just a contradiction of something they have believed. It's adding something to what they have believed that they're not ready for. And it causes people a lot of anguish. People don't like change. I'm just telling you.
Yep.
It's hard to deal with change. It's uncomfortable. All right, Romans chapter 3, verses 21 through 26. We're getting here to the end. Just a couple more scriptures after this and we'll be done.
Now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God, to declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be the just, or be just, and the justifier of him which believes in Jesus.
It just wiped out everything. It wiped out 4,000 years of church history.
Right.
Now, it didn't do away with it in the sense that it wasn't true or it wasn't real. It just had been completed. It had served its purpose. Amen. And for everybody who now believes in Christ, it has been fulfilled. There's no reason to even look back at it other than for context when we're reading the New Testament.
Right.
You see what I mean?
Here, okay, let me just say it this way. We began to inhabit that mystery.
Yes.
We're not just observers. We are inhabiting a mystery.
Thank you, Lord.
All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 15.
Thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift. Because when you really understand this, it'll shut your mouth. You just got to think about it. Right? Praise the Lord. It's unspeakable.
Come on.
The gift is unspeakable. What God has done. I mean.
Shut up, right? I guess it's unspeakable. 1 Peter chapter 1. Verses 2 through 10, and that'll be the end of the scriptures, Mike. 1 Peter 1, 2 through 10.
Elect, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and the sprinkling of blood of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace unto you and peace be multiplied. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope, by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Wherein you greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations, or through trials and tribulations, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold and that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, you love, in whom though now ye see him not, yet believing, you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. Of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. Prophets were prophesying this stuff. They had revelation of the prophecy, but they didn't understand the fullness of the prophecy. You know why? Because they didn't know what questions to ask. It was too big for them. So, here's what I'm saying. After the bewilderment, this wrestling with this unsolvable puzzle that it poses itself. After the, call it vertigo, right? Of staring into this unfathomable mystery. It's like looking down into a great abyss and you go, whoa. That's what this is like. After that, a gate may be open, and all the chatter of religion just becomes a confused whisper that gives way, by the grace of God, to silence and awe. We inhabit this wild, inexhaustible mystery that is the Godhead. That's what this is supposed to be about. Mm-hmm. Exciting. Adventure. I'm glad for the theology that has developed our faith to the place that we're at. I'm not trying to belittle any of that. But we can still continue the adventure out to explore the wild, mysterious territory in which we live and move and have our being. It's Jesus. No beginning, no end. Of the fullness have all we received, and grace for grace. It's revelation. It's Christ in you. It's the Word of God alive in us, wanting to give us greater revelation, deeper understanding of God, greater reality in God, to see these promises come to pass in our lives. Amen?
Amen.
So, I'm not ashamed of asking questions I don't have answers for.
Amen.
I'm just sick of answering, asking the same questions that I already have answers for.
Right.
It's redundant.
Right.
It doesn't serve a purpose. We need to press the envelope, you know? We need to push out into this wild territory in whom we live and move and have our being.
Lord.
And see what's on the other side of the next hill. Amen. The next mountain, the next obstacle, the next situation.
Amen.
That's what this is all about. Amen.
Amen.
Give the Lord a hand tonight. Praise God.
You,
so don't let people mock you when you talk about Revelation. And listen, that's what this is really all about. It started with Revelation. Jesus Christ is the revelation of God. That without that, you don't have anything. But with that, it opens up a whole new world.
Amen.
Praise God. God bless all of you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Thank you for your patience tonight.